Okay, we move to the final item of business, which is a member's business debate on motion 2164 in the name of Stuart McMillan on Scottish history in schools. The debate, as ever, will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members wishing to take part please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function if they're joining us online. And joining us online is Stuart McMillan. I call on Mr. McMillan. He's in the chamber. Excellent. I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I'd like to thank all members from across the chamber who have signed the motion to allow this debate to take place. I was asked to submit the motion to have this debate by a constituent, Gordon Bryce, from the 1820 Society. Now, I heard late last night that Gordon sadly passed away this week. And as such, I would like to pay tribute to him for his enthusiasm and passion for life, but also for his hard work to help educate more people about the 1820 insurrection. I know that he certainly was looking forward to this debate taking place, and as such, I will dedicate my contribution today to him. Maya Angelou stated, "History, despite its wretching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again." Saying also, anyone who argues for the sanitised version of the truth to suit their agenda is wrong. I don't want our classrooms to be consumed by historical lessons that only tell part of the story, simply because the state says so. Historically, that has taken place and is, in my opinion, one of the reasons many of us will often have heard comments from others about the lack of appreciation or understanding of the history of Scotland, for good or bad. I've always believed that having a knowledge of the past is crucial for the present and also the future. And learning about World War II and the atrocities that the Nazi regime ensured that my international outlook in life was there, certainly for going forward. And spending time with young Germans as part of a student exchange programme whilst a teenager, and then studying in Dorton first at university, gave me the opportunity to discuss and learn more about the present at that time and the hopes and aspirations for the future. This was always with the backdrop of that sad recent past shaping the future. And I admire the generations of German people who have faced up to and also owned their past and dedicated themselves to ensuring that history does not repeat itself. So where does this leave Scotland? Now, recently my youngest had a homework project entitled Sir William Wallace, Hero or Traitor? Now, my first reaction was, of course, to say that he was a hero. Go on to the Society of William Wallace website and you can learn more about him and the actions to commemorate him. However, for the educational purposes, the proposed question was actually right. Why should we automatically consider the often written position of history as the only truth? After some further research, my daughter completed the project and came up with her own answer. And I'm pleased to say that she did agree with me on this particular occasion, which I can assure you is not always often. Now, my motion mentions the radical war of 1820. And I first became aware of this part of our history when I was asked to pipe at a memorial in Paisley in 2004. There always seemed to be events about this in Paisley, Strathen, and Glasgow and elsewhere. And I had no knowledge of Inverclyde's sad involvement in this part of our history. I mean, speaking to people from Inverclyde about the radical war, it was obviously a part of our history that was a very well-kept secret. But then it wasn't just my area, it was other parts of Scotland too. At the bottom of Bank Street in Greenock, there's now situated a monument to those citizens who died in the massacre in Cathcart Street on the 8th of April, 1820. John McQuinney, 65. Adam Glafain, 48. John Boyce, 33. Archibald Drummond, 20. James Kerr, 17. Archibald McKinnon, 17. William Lindsay, 15. And James McGilp, 8. These individuals were shot indiscriminately by the Port Glasgow Militia volunteers, who were accompanying five Paisley Weaver prisoners to the Greenock Jail. The radical war was never taught in our school, and certainly I was made aware of the events in school about Peterloo and Tolpuddle. But over many years, the 1820 Society have helped keep this part of our history alive and to bring it to many more people. However, this surely should be a part of our Scottish history, actually being taught in the schools for future generations. As George Orwell stated, the most effective way to destroy people is to deny and obliterate their own understanding of their history. Our history cannot be rewritten, but it should be told in all of its fullness. A further part of the motion centres on Scotland's part in the transatlantic slave trade. Now, this Parliament has agreed to examine how we acknowledge and talk about Scotland's role in this, and also in the Empire. Now, man's subjugation of man is not glorious or positive, no matter how much wealth was actually generated. All across the country, there are examples of how this vile trade enriched the few. My own constituency, it was a global leader in the sugar industry, as well as having involvement in tobacco and cotton. And the sugar warehouses at James Watt Dock were built long after the abolition of slavery. However, clearly the profits over many years in the sugar industry will have played a part in constructing this iconic building. After this chamber voted to ensure that Scotland tells its story, I established a working group to consider the location of a national museum, as I believe that such a facility should be located in Greenock at the sugar warehouses. And there are many reasons why the location is ideal, and I have not yet heard of a sound reason why it should be established elsewhere or even become a network of smaller facilities. If we as a nation genuinely want to tell our story in full, a facility akin to the standalone International Slavery Museum in Liverpool must be what we aim for. In this themed year of Scotland's stories, situating such a museum in Greenock would be fitting. Having that type of facility to visit and as an essential visit for all school pupils would certainly help present and future generations fully understand and appreciate our past. Another reason why I'm so invested in this particular project is due to the letter I received from a young constituent in 2020, where they outlined their experience of the Scottish education system as a black pupil. I was given permission to share the letter with the Education Secretary at the time, and I've had dialogue with the student since. I know that across Scotland there will be other young people of colour who have had a similar school experience compared to white pupils. They will have had a different school experience compared to white pupils. And I think that's actually, I think it's rather sad, to be quite frank with you. This is why I support a review of racial equality in our schools, so that teachers can be better equipped to talk about Scotland's history in its fullness. And I believe a National Human Rights Museum would be instrumental in helping educate people of all ages about Scotland's role in the slave trade and also the Empire. As a former slave abolitionist, Frederick Douglass stated, "It is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men." Now, I quote Douglass for a specific reason. He toured Britain and Ireland and spoke in Greenock on the 10th of April 1846 and also on the 23rd of January 1860. Why then is Scotland not ensuring that this part of our history is fully narrated to future generations? Apart from a small land border, Scotland is surrounded by water. Where is the greater historical education about how Scotland's maritime past generated wealth and inequality, including our involvement in assisting the Confederacy in the American Civil War? This is where the Clyde Atlantic Trust and its campaign to both help educate present and future generations about the Clyde's Atlantic history is a national story that needs to be told. They too are campaigning to create a museum using immersive technology to help tell that story. Educational, this would be fascinating and hugely important in helping us understand our trading past. Finally, also, there are many, many more examples of our history that should be told in our curriculum. And I accept that we cannot tell them all. But I do not consider the job of our educators to be easy in this particular regard, which is why I support further resources to support teachers in this task. I'll end my speech with one other quote, which I believe to be fitting for this debate. It also comes from Frederick Douglass. "The life of a nation is secure only while the nation is honest, truthful, and virtuous." Presiding Officer, we have that opportunity to be honest, truthful, and virtuous to help future generations. We owe it to them in memory of those that have gone before us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. Having not spotted you in the chamber, I thought I'd reward you or compensate you by giving you a little extra time. But we are heavily subscribed this evening, so I'd be grateful if members would try to stick to roughly their speech limits. On that basis, I call Kenneth Gibson, who will be followed by Murdo Fraser again for around 4 minutes, please, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate my colleague Stuart McMillan on securing this evening's debate. The teaching of history should be exciting and inspirational. The great French philosopher and historian Voltaire said, "We look to Scotland for all our ideas of civilization." In 18th century, European thinkers challenged old ideas about almost every aspect of life, arguing that the way forward was to use reason when seeking answers. Scotland truly was the Athens of the North. Pupils could do worse than reading Arthur Herman's How the Scots Invented the Modern World, the true story of how Western Europe's poorest nation created our world and everything in it, which examines the Scottish Enlightenment's profound impact on intellectual thought across the globe. If we are to build the confidence of our young people, the incredible achievements of our forebears should be discussed. In Ayrshire alone, with Alexander Fleming, Henry Fowles and William Murdoch, who discovered penicillin, fingerprinting and invented gas lighting, respectively. Stuart McMillan's Greenock had steam engine inventor James Watt. It's sad that 15 years into an SNP government, the Enlightenment, Scottish invention and discovery is not at the core of Scottish history teaching. What other nation would omit such astonishing contributions to humanity? The cringe remains. In primary school, I was lucky to be taught by Miss McCreef, whose passion for Scottish history brought us the decisive Pictish victory over the Northumbrians at Nectonsmere in 685, Athelstanford, the Maine of Norway, and Wars of Independence. Miss McCreef also focused on the slave trade, particularly the role of the tobacco lords, whose wealth was based in Virginia and the Caribbean plantations, where many Scots were overseers or indentured, while in chattel slavery, vast numbers of Africans toiled. Secondary school was completely different. The 1970s history curriculum was absolutely dire. No Scottish history was taught at all. Claudius' successful Roman invasion of England and the resistance of Caractacus was covered, but without mention of Calgacus and Mons Gropius, Hadrian's and Antonine's walls, or the subsequent collapse of Roman Britain. The centuries in which the Anglo-Saxons overran and transformed much of Britain were completely ignored, as was the establishment of Dalriada, which eventually grew into the Kingdom of Scots. Alfred of Wessex burning the cakes prior to fighting the Vikings was followed by a leap of centuries to the life of a medieval English peasant. They ate a lot of herring, barley, onions while growing walnut and mulberry trees, apparently. There was no mention of their place in the feudal system, frequent famines, pestilence, violence or grinding poverty that beset their lives. Henry VIII's closure of the monasteries was covered, but with no word of Scotland's own Reformation. We then jumped to spend 3 years learning the social history of England from 1815 to 1914. Peterloo, the Poor Law Reform Act, Catholic Emancipation, the Chartists, Tallpuddle Martyrs, Life in the Dark, Satanic Mills of Northern England, etc. Labour history, but without the Industrial Revolution, New Lanark, Highland Clearances or the potato famines in both Scotland and Ireland, which fundamentally shaped the Scotland of today. Of the Union of the Crowns and Union of Parliament, Scottish Enlightenment, Rise of Britain's Empire and Scotland's role in it, Scotland's myriad pioneers in medicine, engineering, the sciences and exploration? Nothing. It could have been worse. If St Gerard's and Govan, they would spend an entire year studying the history of Salisbury Town, much to the pupils' bewilderment. The snapshots of Scottish history being taught now at National 5 and higher are much better than before, but remain limited. Teachers select one of five topics from the Wars of Independence, Mary Queen of Scots and Reformation, Treaty of Union, Migration and Empire, Great War. It's still desperately unambitious given the years of learning available through our pupils' school life. Presiding officer, history should start at the beginning and be honest, warts and all. How did we get here? Out of Africa, to the early settlers' arrival in the wake of the last ice age, to the great migrations of the Celtic tribes, Roman invasion, Anglo-Saxons and Vikings. St. Columba's arrival in 563 to spread Christianity. Kenneth MacAlpine's victory over Pictland, the slow unification of Scotland to more or less within our present mainland boundaries in the 10th and 11th centuries, and in the Clyde and Hebridean Islands in 1266 and Northern Islands in 1472. Especially now, the cataclysmic impact of the Black Death, which killed up to half of Scotland's population in 1350, Reformation, Union of the Crowns, Union of Parliaments, Industrial Revolution, Risings, Clearances, Empire, and their perspective and impact, and indeed their importance, they should be covered. The lives of kings, queens, and everybody else. Scottish history is exciting, but only if we make it so.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I now call on Murdo Fraser to be followed by Rona Mackay for around 4 minutes, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating Stuart McMillan on securing this debate and thank him for his motion, which I was very happy to sign, and thank him for his excellent opening speech, which I thought covered the ground very well. And I very much enjoyed the breathless tour de force we've just heard from Mr. Gibson, summing up thousands of years of Scottish history in 4 minutes. So well done. It's a subject I've got a real interest in. I remember when I was very young reading a battered copy of Walter Scott's Tales of a Grandfather, which, despite being 2 centuries old, summed up early Scottish history very well. It's a subject I've read, I've studied, I've written about, I've lectured in, and still receive small sums in royalties from a book I wrote some years ago, still available on Amazon, and an excellent read I would commend to the Chamber. Stuart McMillan raised some really interesting points in his opening contribution. I think it is important that the history we teach in schools has to be set in an international context. So we have to have Scottish history in the context of British history, in the context of European and world history. But I absolutely agree with the thrust of both speeches we've heard so far, that we need to start with our own history, understanding who we are as a people. And I simply don't think we have enough of that in Scottish schools, and in that respect I would agree with Mr. Gibson. And I know that there are aspects of Scottish history that are taught well. We hear a lot about the Wars of Independence, the Highland Clearances are taught, but whole swathes are totally ignored. Stuart McMillan talked about the Radical War of 1820, Kenneth Gibson talked about the Enlightenment, my passions in the 17th century, the great struggles between Royalists and Covenanters and Cromwell, that were the start of the modern world, where we settled the big questions about how we would be governed, what would be the relationship between king and parliament and the people, how people would be free to worship their God as they saw fit. And all these were settled, including, of course, the relationship between Scotland and England, in the course of the 17th century and early 18th century. None of that is taught in Scottish schools. It is completely ignored as a topic, and yet is vitally important. And I think if we're going to have well-rounded pupils, people coming out of school with a proper understanding of their country and where it came from, we need to get that right. Two other points I'll make, Presiding Officer, because time is short. Where history is taught in schools, we need to make sure it's accurate. I was appalled to see recently there was a report of materials being used in Scottish schools about Churchill sending the tanks into George Square. Churchill did not send the tanks into George Square, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a myth which has been disproved by all historians, and yet somehow this ended up as a material in a Scottish school, and that's simply not good enough. And the further point I'd make is one that's been raised by Neil McLennan, former president of the Scottish Association of Teachers of History, one of our most experienced and authoritative voices in this area. And he's raised concerns about the impact of politics on the teaching of history, and in particular, the impact of nationalism. Because in his view, there's a danger that this is making Scottish history too parochial, presenting a sanitised version of Scottish history. And the example he gave was one actually that Stuart McMillan referred to on the teaching of slavery and the Atlantic slave trade, whereby materials being used identify Liverpool and Bristol as ports being used for the slave trade, but there's no mention of any Scottish ports such as Glasgow or Greenock. And in his view, that is very unfortunate. Now, in 2011, the Royal Society of Edinburgh called for a review of history teaching in schools to try and address some of these concerns, some of the concerns we've heard today in this debate. That call at that time was rejected by the Scottish Government. I think it is now time for that issue to be revisited. And already in this debate, we've heard from different perspectives concerns about the way history is being taught. I think it's time for a full refresh of history qualifications, a revision of the curriculum for excellence, to make sure that our young people leaving schools get a proper grounding in the history of their country, and make sure that that history is accurate and fair and balanced. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Mr. Fraser, I now call on Rona Mackay, who joins us remotely, and Ms. Mackay will be followed by Martin Whitfield. Ms. Mackay, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for bringing this debate to the Chamber. It's clear from the number of speakers lined up just how important it is for this subject to be debated. Presiding Officer, I didn't like history when I was at school, and pretty much everything I now know about Scottish history I've learned over the decades since I left school. I learned more about the Battle of Hastings and Oliver Cromwell than I did about the Battle of Bannockburn or the Highland Clearances. I've tried to analyse why I found the subject boring, and I can only conclude it's because I had no interest in learning a timeline of dates of battles. Battle of Hastings springs to mind, nor the succession of the royal family. To be honest, I still have no interest in these things. I realise that my generation learned little or no Scottish history, the history of my own nation. What I have learned since my school days, though, I find fascinating. Scotland has a rich, enlightened history, which I could never find boring. These days, I lap up the fascinating histories from countries all over the world. Presiding officer, I'm aware that history taught throughout schools in Scotland now is more relevant, but no nation should allow the erasing of its history be, because it was erased in the curriculum, and I find that shocking. Erasing women from our history was common too, and it's only now gradually beginning to get better. We did learn about a handful of our great Scottish inventors, Alexander Fleming and John Logie Baird, for example, but I would love to have known about Elsie Ingalls, Jane Haining, the Edinburgh Seven, Victoria Drummond, and so many more women pioneers to whom Scotland is indebted. I would also have liked to know about the part Scotland played in the slave trade, burning witches, the clan wars and the clearances, just some of the historical events where we hardly covered ourselves in glory, but it should have been taught. But those stories weren't told, and therein lies the problem, because young people deserve to know the full picture of their nation's historical past. And as Stuart McMillan's motion acknowledges, it's just as important for children to know about their local area's historical past, as well as Scotland as a nation. Presiding officer, Hunters Hill House in Bishop Briggs in my constituency of Strathkelvin and Bearsden was the birthplace of Scotland's father of democracy, Thomas Muir. Sadly, the house has been sold off to a developer and left to rot, to the shame of our local council. Thomas Muir was a towering figure in Scottish history, yet I learned nothing of him at school. There is a local campaign group, the Friends of Thomas Muir, who do great work in my constituency in promoting his memory today. And I believe his legacy is now taught in schools in Eastern Bartonshire, but too many people of my generation will be completely unaware of this incredible man. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome any move that will educate our young people about Scotland's history, warts and all, because without knowing where we've been, we don't know where we are now and how far we've come. So I'd like to thank the many teachers, community groups and museums throughout Scotland who recognise this and are dedicated to educating our youngsters on their history. And finally, can I thank Stuart McMillan again for securing this important debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. I now call on Martin Whitfield, who will be followed by Siobhan Brown again around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. And first, can I extend my thanks to Stuart McMillan for collecting this debate, but can I also echo his condolences to his constituent for the work that they've done. And it's a great shame that he wasn't able to listen to the discussion here in this chamber. I'm reminded, of course, of what Cicero said about history, which is that we study it not to be clever in another time, but to be wise always. And I find myself standing probably in some opposition to what I've heard today. I almost sought to intervene on Murdo Fraser to ask, so what do we drop from the curriculum to fit it all in? Because the curriculum for excellence was with thought drafted when it came to the aspect of history, or indeed the past as it's described in there within social studies. And I wanted to raise the Curriculum for Excellence benchmarks and to talk about what it is that teachers look for when they're seeking an assurance that a young person is sufficiently knowledgeable in an area to move on. And indeed, if we look at the third level, which is the start of high school for most children, 4 out of the 11 aspects that a teacher needs to find has to be specifically about a Scottish aspect of history. When we move to the fourth level, it becomes only 1 in 16. And I wanted to look at the reason why that is the case. And to do that, I think we need to turn to Article 29 of the UNCRC, the right to an education, and what it means to be educated. And indeed, Article 29 says that our young people should build their respect for other people and the world around them. In particular, they should learn to respect their rights, rights of others, freedoms of others, their parents, their identity, language, and values of countries, including their own. If they take but a microscopic view of Scottish history, they will not only fail to actually understand why we are where we are today, but our young people will also fail to appreciate the global history that has in fact formed the position that we are in today. More than,
Kenneth Gibson.
My focus is only on Scottish history. I absolutely accept, and I think everyone else does, that that must be within a context of British and European and world history. It's just getting the Scottish aspect of that right, so it's warts and all, and covers a greater depth in Scotland's history, as myself and others have already stated.
Mr Whitfield, and I can give you the time back.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful for that intervention because I am concerned that whenever history is discussed, people talk about it from their own point of view of history, rather than actually the role of our teachers, which is to inspire our young people to look at history in their own right, to find their own history, which happens in primary schools, where we trace the ancestry of families, the people around who fought. They look at the close knit around the school, around their community, and a widening understanding of what has happened. So, I had the privilege to teach in Preston Pans, where we taught the Jacobite uprising because of the Battle of Preston Pans. Very important, both to those young people who live there, but also to a wider understanding of history. But I come back to the intervention I nearly made on Murdo Fraser. What is it we are going to miss out to guide these young people to where they are? Because what we seek through the curriculum for excellence is to teach the skills that they need to analyse a situation and bring their own opinion to it. How you teach those skills should rightly rest with the teacher, the pupils themselves, what interests them, the school and their community. So it may be for the young people of Preston Pans that the Battle of Preston Pans is a way to learn about primary and secondary evidence, and also to analyse why an event happened that is heralded by some people from one view and another from a diametrically opposite. So, to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, because I know time is tight, there is a concern where politicians influence the history that's taught in schools, and I would urge us to take a slight step back. Let us trust the teachers of Scotland, but more importantly, let us trust our young people in Scotland so that they can say what it is they want to learn, and through that we can teach them the skills to be the great historians we need to be so they understand where we are today. I'm grateful.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Whitfield. I now call our next speaker, which is Siobhan Brown, who joins us remotely, who will be followed by Alistair Allen for around 4 minutes, Ms Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for bringing this debate to the Chamber as well. I grew up in Australia, and although Australia has an interesting, albeit shorter, history, I've always been fascinated with the long and detailed tapestry that is the history of the country I now call home, Scotland. When you mention my constituency of Ayr, people initially picture Robbie Burns, Scotland's most famous son, and quite rightly so, but there's so much more to my constituency than that. But before I turn to the importance of local history, I want to take you back to the classroom. And I think, as my colleague Rona Mackay alluded to earlier, when talking to my friends and family who went to school here, I often hear echoes of how much they hated the subject of history. So let me say, history is much more than royalty, dates, places, and acts of parliament. It's people. It's ordinary people like you and I. It's our ancestors. It's our cultural identity. It's our sense of place. It's who we are. Let's take a trip to Ayr first and talk about the subject which fascinates most children, witches, and of course, witch trials. Now, saying that, you might transport yourself to Salem, but stay where you are. Did you know about Ayr witch trials? While 20 women were tried and found guilty in Boston town, women and children were being persecuted in Ayr, as they were around Scotland, 4,000 of them, due to religious intolerance and mass hysteria. And children looking at these stories can read the names, which are still present in Ayr town: Bell, Campbell, Cunningham, McCall, Sloan, Thompson, Wilson, and Young. And that is how history can captivate. How much more interested will a child be when they see that they or their relatives have similar names and realise it could have been them if they'd lived in those days? To capture the interest in the young, we must bring history home and local. After that, it's much easier to look at the national and world events. Moving to Prestwick and the first home of the Open Golf Championship in 1860. Here we have Scotland's oldest baronial borough dating back more than 1,000 years. There are connections to King James VI and Robert the Bruce, who is said to have drank the water there. Ask any school pupil in Prestwick, and I'm sure they'll be able to tell you. When you picture Troon, you picture its rich golfing history. But take a trip to Crosby Church, the site which has been there since 1229, and in one form or the other, and finds tales of Scottish kings and the assassination of James V's illegitimate son. With the advancement of technology, we can immerse ourselves in history at the click of a button from anywhere in the world. We have wonderful Facebook pages such as Remembering Old Air, which was set up by Richard Devine and now has close to 24,000 followers worldwide. Richard and the team who run the page have a deep knowledge and passion for local history and air, and also deliver local historical tours, telling stories that are personal to the town and can have up to 60 people attend each tour. I'd love to see our local schools connect with these groups to learn more about local history, things that they'll never find in the school textbooks. There are also dark times in local history. Indeed, my colleague included this in the motion, the importance of educating ourselves on Scotland's role in the transatlantic slave trade. Our children should be encouraged to be proud of the good and reflect and learn from the darker periods. And we cannot forget our own political history. In 1315, Robert the Bruce convened the first meeting of the Scottish Parliament in the Church of St John of the Baptist in Ayr. So let's teach our children more Scottish history. Teach them local history. Take them to the places steeped in it. And most importantly, tell the stories about their ancestors. We will all become history one day, so the stories and teachings must continue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Brown. I now call on Alistair Allen, who will be followed by Stephen Kerr. Dr Allen, for around 4 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, can I firstly congratulate Stuart McMillan for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. There are many arguments for teaching more Scottish history in our schools, its potential to empower young people, as we've heard, being chief among them. However, let me come at this debate from a particular angle. Things are certainly getting better, and let me say that at the outset and give teachers credit for it. However, Scots have, until very recently, often learned so little about their own country's history that the situation could and has been described as profoundly abnormal. I seem to remember a survey a few years ago that found that only around half of Scots had, to take one example, ever heard of the Declaration of Arbroath. This isn't normal. It is not readily possible to imagine a Norway where anyone had not heard of the Eidsvoll Constitution, or a France in which a soul had not heard of the Bastille. And yet Kenneth Gibson's account of what was not taught in secondary school history to his generation or to mine does explain a lot. So why is Scotland such an outlier in all this? Well, the fact is that until very recently, the teaching of Scottish history or Scottish literature or indeed Scottish geography it has relied almost entirely on the enthusiasm of individual teachers. There was in the past simply no official expectation that children and young people in Scotland need to learn anything very much about Scotland. Perhaps some of the blame for that lies in the way that we have ceased to think of history, both the bits that we like and the bits that make us shudder at ourselves, as a story. And yet there is no shortage of stories of either kind in Scotland, from the ancient houses at Skara Brae to the Art of the Picts, the statutes of Iona to the Battle of Largs, to James II of Scotland blowing himself up with his own cannon in Roxburgh, to the growth of a school in every or most parishes, the sorry and financially interlinked stories of the slave trade and the Highland clearances. We should ultimately teach this stuff, not just because it might promote the development of any particular skill or create any particular economic benefit, but because it's interesting and because it makes you think. The evidence from schools around Scotland is that young people find it interesting too, and it inspires them in all sorts of other areas of the curriculum. We should teach it because without some of this information, young Scots will find it impossible to locate themselves in Scotland's story. And I have to counter Mr. Whitfield. None of this is a case for teaching less world history, and we will, I hope, have no more complaints from others to that effect in this Parliament condemning school trips to Bannockburn. So let's get past the anxieties which some people seem to have. Teaching young Scots about their country is a political act. It isn't. but not teaching them about it, as many of us in secondary school were barely taught, most certainly is a political act. In 2011, perhaps the most hostile crowd I have ever faced in this place was when I proposed successfully that young Scots doing higher English should have to learn about at least one Scottish writer. This was an idea which a number of members seemed to regard the sign that the barbarians were not so much at the gates as melting the gates down and making them into weapons of mass destruction. So, Presiding Officer, I believe and I certainly hope that we are getting beyond all of that anxiety about teaching about Scotland in schools. It's entirely reasonable for any country to know its history, good and bad, and not to be afraid to do so. I support the motion.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Allen. Before moving to the next speaker, and despite the commendable efforts of all speakers to date to stick to their time limits, I'm conscious of the number of speakers that still want to contribute to the debate, and therefore I'm minded to take a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I would ask Stuart McMillan to move such a motion.
Okay. Move, Presiding Officer.
Are we all agreed? Excellent. The debate is now extended by up to 30 minutes, and I call Stephen Kerr, who will be followed by Denny Minto for around 4 minutes. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I presume that doesn't mean I can speak for up to that period of time. I'm sure you correct me. But can I just say how much I've really enjoyed this debate and want to commend Stuart McMillan, not just for securing debate, but for giving a really fine speech to open this debate and set a really balanced tone to the way that we're discussing this. I would like to talk about my love of history. I love history. And the reason I love history is because inspirational teachers imbued me with a love of history. And it's true that there probably aren't enough classroom hours to cover the curriculum that was outlined by Kenny Gibson, but it is possible to inspire young people to leave a classroom with a desire to know more by doing their own research. And I think that was part of what Martin Whitfield was saying in his speech, which I also enjoyed greatly. I have to say, by the way, that my love of history is entirely amateur, unlike my colleague, Murdo Fraser, who is a professional because he's receiving fees from his royalties from his book, which apparently is available on Amazon. Do you want me to repeat that? That's a gratuitous advertisement. But when we're celebrating Scotland's history, we really must be careful, as has been pointed out by a number of speakers, not to examine it solely through the lenses of nostalgia or ideology. This is particularly true, of course, when it comes to teaching history in schools. We must encourage pupils to have a broad and critical understanding of our history, as they study history, to ask the searching and difficult questions about our past, emphasising the importance of creating as accurate a picture as possible based on bona fide research and historical evidence. Sadly, I fear the way that history is sometimes being taught in our schools does not live up to the standard. And I wish to return to the theme that my colleague Murdo Fraser mentioned earlier, quoting the same source, Neil McLennan, the senior lecturer, and of course I will.
Minister. A member could name a specific school where he has such concerns.
No,
Stephen Kerr.
I think it would be wholly improper of me in this debating chamber to entertain such a question. However, nationalist nostalgia and ideology are increasingly seeping into the curriculum, creating a one-sided and inaccurate representation of our shared history. I mentioned earlier that I am going to quote from Neil McLennan, Senior Lecturer and Director of Leadership Programmes at the University of Aberdeen. And the example of the slave trade was already cited by Murdo Fraser. I'm going to quote exactly what he says. If you read guidance from the SQA, the curriculum gives examples of slave ports like Liverpool and Bristol, but the slave trade wasn't solely centred on England. And it goes on, McLennan asks for Glasgow to be inserted. Of course I will.
Kenneth
when
Gibson.
I was in secondary school, we never get 1 hour of Scottish history, so it was bound to be focused on Bristol and Liverpool and the slave trade. But in actual fact, we didn't have the slave trade at secondary school, but we did get, as I said in my speech, the tobacco lords and the slave trade when I was at primary school 50 years ago.
Well, with the greatest, I think we're about the same vintage, so I'm not going to say anything insulting here, but I'm talking about the current curriculum, not the one that you and I probably went through, and he has asked for Glasgow to be inserted, but this hasn't happened. And asked why, in the newspaper article reported in the Herald on Sunday, McLennan said, is it because the system is so bureaucratic even minor reforms are too hard to do. That's very worrying, if so, he says. Is it because of power balances that those in coveted positions don't fancy those changes? Or is it because of a number underbelly of parochialism linked to nationalism where those changes are unpalatable? Of course I will.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank Mr Kerr for taking the intervention. I'm quite sure that Mr Kerr heard my opening contribution. I couldn't have been any stronger in terms of what we need to do in terms of the transatlantic slave trade. Now, I did read the same article that Mr Kerr has done, but I'm sure that Mr Kerr would also acknowledge that my contribution in this debate and my how I set this debate out, that there's no narrow nationalism, there's no imperialism, none of that nonsense. It was about having education, it was about having history, so that we can educate our present and future generations so they know what's and all what Scotland was like in the past.
Stephen Kerr, I can give you most of that time back.
Oh, right. Thank you very much, Deputy President. Actually, this is not the first time that Stuart McMillan and I have had an exchange like this in this chamber. And I recognise what I'm saying is not necessarily representative of the feelings of every nationalist, let alone every member of the SNP that sits in this chamber. I accept that. But within the nationalist movement, there is a fear that presenting a more accurate representation of Scotland's history will create a negative narrative. And some even go as far as to describe this as talking Scotland down. And I'm sorry, but I'm sure that Stuart McMillan and I would agree with this, that is plain nonsense.
Stuart McMillan, very briefly,
please. It's a very brief one, yes. Mr Kerr, I'm not arguing for a more accurate, I'm just arguing for an accurate version of history.
Stephen Kerr.
I take that point entirely, and I'm not ascribing these views to any particular member in this chamber tonight. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm way over time. I can tell that I will wear your patience even thinner. So let me conclude by saying we have a proud history, but not a perfect one. We should take pride from our many achievements as Scots, but also learn from our mistakes. Not only will this present a more accurate picture of Scotland's past, but will aid us in our aim to develop Scotland in the present for the better.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Jenny Minto to be followed by Claire Adamson for around 4 minutes, Ms Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to add my congratulations to Stuart McMillan on securing this debate. It is extremely poignant to be discussing the teaching of Scottish history in our schools when we have just lost a foremost historian, Professor Ted Cowan, a popular and influential champion of Scots history. I met him in connection with some of the many times he took to television to spread the word beyond the academic sphere. For many of us, Ted's tracing of the origins of the American Declaration of Independence back to the Declaration of Arbroath in 1320 was fascinating and inspiring. It is fitting that we pay tribute to him in this debate about the importance of understanding Scotland's past in order to shape its present and future. Prior to being elected to serve Argyll and Bute, I managed the Museum of Isle of Life, and I should declare an interest here as I remain a trustee. Stuart McMillan's motion emphasises the importance of such local museums in revealing the continuity of shared values and culture that our communities enjoy, that makes every community unique and special, which my colleague Siobhan Brown touched upon. So let me open the doors of the Museum of Isle of Life and reveal some of its treasures, which are of Isla, but also give the wider links that Martin Whitfield raised in his contribution. First of all, there's a 12,000-year-old flint tool made shortly after the last ice age by Mesolithic hunters and gatherers. They were Isla's first inhabitants and just one of many waves of immigrants who have made Isla and Scotland what it is today. Then we come to the illicit still. Today we pay taxes on the whisky we make on Isla, but the island's vastly successful whisky industry has its roots in an ancient skill imported from Ireland and honed over centuries by entrepreneurs and innovators, a continuity of culture that has profound impact on Isla's economy. Today we export whisky, but sadly Isla once exported people. Poverty and clearance made sure of that. Emigrants flooded abroad, and those islanders that remained had kinfolk in Australia, New Zealand, Canada and America. And so we come to a century-old hand-sewn stars and stripes. Isla folk didn't just serve in World War I, That conflict came to Isla's shores in 1918 with the wreck of two troop ships and the loss of hundreds of young American soldiers and their British crews. The people of Isla behaved with great courage to rescue men from the sea. They gathered the bodies of the dead and buried them with respect. Four local women sat up all night sewing a stars and stripes to honour the dead before the first mass funeral. That flag, gifted to an American president, now belongs to the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. But as it is so much part of the history of Isla, it has been displayed in the island's own museum since 2018. That year, I worked with the fantastic primary and secondary school teachers and children to bring that story alive. And like Martin Whitfield has talked about, the curriculum for excellence and the evidence and the stories and contradictions were all brought into these lessons. And it was clear that we needed to show how their community was part of one of the great events of world history. Their island isn't just a dot on a map, but a community with a unique and valuable take on the world, past and present. All communities are like that. My constituency is blessed with many, many great local museums. Lismore, Ling, Seal, Auchendrayne, Kilmartin, just too many more to mention. All have their unique stories to tell. As Stuart McMillan said, this is Scotland's year of storytelling, a fitting time to celebrate the stories that have come down to us from our past and enrich and inform the lives we lead today. In finishing, Presiding Officer, Ted Cowan was a storyteller. As a professor and teacher, he inspired generations of Scots historians. And as a writer and charismatic broadcaster, he informed and enthralled a much wider audience. There is still much that Ted Cowan would have wanted to be done, and this motion addresses that. Scottish history is certainly not all glorious and good, but it made us who we are, led us to where we are now, and guides us towards where we are heading.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Ms Minto. I now call on Claire Adamson to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury for around 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I also thank Stuart McMillan for securing tonight's debate, which has been absolutely fascinating. I've enjoyed the contributions from across the chamber. I'd also like to extend my condolences to George Bryce's friends and family. I'm sure he would have enjoyed tonight so much. And a thank you to Jenny Minto too for evoking a wonderful holiday I had in Isla this summer and was able to visit the Museum of Island Life. And I know she was very instrumental in getting that set up and working on it over the years. So thank you for my enjoyment of your history in Isla. History is so important in understanding the culture of our country, but that includes telling the history in its full and often challenging truth. And from the perspective of all, that means acknowledging injustice to women, to children, to ethnic minorities, and the impact on the conquered as well as the conqueror. Not for the first time in this chamber, I turned to my experience in visiting the Canadian Museum of Human Rights in Winnipeg in 2017. A profound experience. The museum is seen as a national and international destination and centre of learning, where people from all around the world can engage in discussion about and commit to taking action against hate and oppression. The two aspects that I took from the museum are the first one is the educational engagement, the way they work with young people. And it's demonstrated by one of the exhibits, which is a real court experience young people can have when they take on the role of a jury member, hear real evidence and reach a conclusion. They then hear the true life verdict and the arguments of the lawyers and the judge involved, and they examine their actual ruling and their understanding of it. But the second aspect, perhaps more important, was bearing honest witness to the past and what colonialism has meant for Canada as a country. And that included recognising the injustice on First Nation people and the history of the damage, particularly forced adoption, into a culture and a religion. And we're still uncovering the truth of that, as shown by the recent demonstrations of anger. Indeed, some of the monuments I visited in Winnipeg were recently vandalised with people as more of the truth and of that history came out. And this is something all nations are having to deal with and examine, and I don't know how to square this circle at all. And I know Ted Cowan would have these views, but also Tom Devine spoke about on the National Library of Scotland sanitising some of the colonial language as, quote, an anachronism by imposing the values and, in this case, the terminology and language of the present on the past 2 centuries or more ago. So we all have to come... Yes, I will.
Kenneth Gibson.
The British Empire, I think, is a really fascinating part of our history, but surely most of the people in Scotland, for example, those who left Scotland at that time, were themselves suffering from desperate poverty, living in subsistence at farms, working in mines, mills, etc. They weren't part of any necessary oppression of other peoples, and they themselves were effectively suffering quite desperately for much of their lives. And I think that's the
clear Adam's thing
to recall.
Well, I think that's absolutely why we have to, and I go back to my initial thoughts, this means we acknowledge the injustice to women, to children, to ethnic minorities, to those who suffered under the regimes of the past, and we have to learn from those. So thank you for raising that with me, Mr. Gibson. The museum in Canada also tells the story of the genocides of the world, including the Holodomor in the Ukraine, shamefully yet to be recognised by the UK government as a genocide. But what laser focus that history puts on the current crisis on the Ukrainian border, and this is why history is so important. Education and bearing honest witness to those principles have influenced my work with local North Lanarkshire councillors, Danish Ashraf and Aggie McGowan, when they presented a motion asking for education to include an honest look at the colonial history of our country. I was delighted when North Lanarkshire Council agreed to that motion and embraced the message of Black Lives Matter. And this is why the curriculum is so important. So whether we're talking about Scarab Ray or Maze Howe, or we're looking to the Roman history, and I have a Roman bathhouse in my own constituency in Strathclyde Park, or through the Wars of Independence, the Covenanters, the Reformation, through to our modern history, where we can celebrate the Glasgow Girls and their success in preventing dawn raids of asylum seekers and achieving the right to further and higher education in our country. What we must ensure for our pupils is that they are fully informed, they are educated in analysis and reflection, and they are confident in their own look at history so that their actions today will lead to a better future through their understanding of our past.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms. Adamson. I can assure members that the repeated references to Scarab Ray have not gone unnoticed in the chair. I call on Faisal Chowdhury, who will be followed by Stephanie Callaghan, around 4 minutes, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Stuart McMillan for bringing this issue to the Chamber. I very much appreciate that this motion acknowledges the growing number of people who believe that the teaching of history should include an honest representation of the more shameful aspects of Scotland's past, such as its involvement in the transatlantic slave trade. I should start by emphasizing why it is so important to include this in the teaching of Scottish history. It is not an attempt to talk the country down, as some critics in the wider national media would have us believe. It has two clear constructive purposes. Firstly, to allow students to understand the horror of the past with a view to ensuring that they are never to be repeated. And secondly, to ensure that students develop a realistic appraisal of how far we have come as a nation and as a society, and how far we still have to go. A proper teaching of these aspects of our history gives context to the ongoing struggle for racial justice, both here and around the world. Scottish history lessons must also find a place for the voice of Joseph Knight, a former slave and a domestic servant, whose successful court case in Edinburgh in 1977 was founded on the principle that no man is the property of another, and for the voices of Quaker women who spoke up in Edinburgh against slavery, supporting abolitionist Frederick Douglass in his speaking tour in the 1840s. Craving his campaign messages on the side of Arthur Setz in Holyrood Park, not so far from where the Scottish Parliament sits today. Changing our approach will allow students to understand why that struggle proceeds at different speeds from one place to another, to see how its legacy affects people of different background and experiences in difficult ways, and perhaps most importantly, to understand how the move towards racial justice from abolition onwards and have strengthened us. We're better off as a society when everybody's human dignity is respected. I would like to both highlight and uphold the measures recently implemented in Wales, which seeks to ensure a good ground in Black and Asian and minority ethnic studies for every student. This encompasses the study of history, identity, and culture. The history component includes teaching of the involvement of Wales in slavery and colonialism. While there are differences in the educational framework between our respective countries, I do not see any reason why Scotland could not aspire to this kind of approaches. I believe this is something that we should move towards, and that teaching of Scottish history would be more comprehensive and inclusive for it. I know that this view is shared by colleagues across the chamber today, and I would welcome an assurance from the Minister in concluding this debate that can all work together on taking these issues towards. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Chaudhry. I now call on Stephanie Callaghan, who joins us remotely, and she'll be followed by Cocab Stewart for around 4 minutes, Ms. Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I add my congratulations to Stuart McMillan for securing this debate today. I believe that to live in Scotland is to live in history. History is a story of us, as we've been born a wee bit earlier. Teaching Scottish history in schools helps us to understand Scotland's place in the world, showing how past decisions still influence and shape our choices today. To illustrate Scotland's living history, there's no better place to start than my own constituency of Uddingston and Bells Hill, the birthplace of Scottish trade unionist and supporter of Home Rule, James Keir Hardie. This proud legacy has shaped my own politics and still links my community to those fiercely progressive views today, more than 100 years after his death. Scotland has forged a formidable history with an influence and legacy that reaches well beyond our shores, from noble clansmen and powerful monarchs to enlightened philosophers and world-famous engineers and scientists. We are a nation that survived and thrived on the kindness and hospitality of our neighbours and kinfolk. Yet we're also a nation that's experienced the shock and abuse of traditional hospitality, which led to the dreadful massacre at Glencoe in 1692. Our history is at once global and Indigenous, with a mix of kinship and conflict, and history in schools allows our young people to explore these associations between the local, the national and the global too. Our lives and our histories are also shaped by a sense of place, and I applaud history teachers who have taken learning from the classroom into the local community by forging innovative links with local organisations, including museums and historical societies. It takes partnership to deliver a truly inclusive curriculum, and forging and strengthening these partnerships lifts history teaching beyond textbooks and has the potential to elicit new and important information on who we are and where we come from. Presiding Officer, I too, like Stuart, would like to commend the efforts of organisations working to this end in my own constituency, and that includes Hamilton Mausoleum Trust, the Low Parks Museum, Bodwell Castle, and the Lanarkshire Family History Society. One really good example, actually, as well, is the wonderful online multimedia archive, Powerful Heritage, and their work with local schools has uncovered the heritage stories of Muslim and South Asian migrants to Scotland. And this includes a fascinating account of the provenance and set-up of the new Stevenson Mosque in my constituency. And that was led by long-time resident of Holytown, Ghulam Saqlan Sadiq. Presiding Officer, I said earlier that to live in Scotland is to live in history. And this, for me, includes ensuring the teaching of our nation's darkest historical moments, as already has been mentioned by others.
but none more so than our significant involvement in the abhorrent transatlantic slave trade, as well as Scotland's part in the often brutal legacy of the British Empire. It's clear that without this knowledge, we cannot fully understand our country's place in the world and why we live the way that we do today. So yes, history will always be a source of debate over whose stories we tell, and that is how it should be. However, schools and local historians need to be in it together, working towards an understanding not just of history writ large, but of diverse traditions and communities that have never been properly recognised and remembered. Learning through history, and specifically local history, has immense potential to help meet the aims of Scotland's curriculum for excellence. And as we strive to develop the four fundamental curriculum capacities that we want to see in our children, successful learners, confident individuals, responsible citizens and effective contributors, the key is exercising flexibility to keep learning meaningful, accessible and enjoyable too. In closing, Presiding Officer, let us bring the gripping narratives of Scotland's past alive to make sense of our world today and to inspire the next generation of Scots to become the responsible and ethical leaders of tomorrow, locally, nationally and globally. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. And I now call final speaker in the open debate, Cockhead Stuart, for around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to Stuart McMillan for bringing this debate, and to all my colleagues' contributions on a subject that is of great interest to me, not least due to my previous employment as a teacher, having taught a little bit of the subjects that have already been mentioned. When learning about history at school in England as much as in Scotland, I was curious and a little bit disappointed at the lack of content regarding events and significant figures of black and minority ethnic heritage and culture. Whilst we've made some progress in diversifying our curriculum, we still have a way to go in making sure that we can all see ourselves in our shared histories and, of course, her stories. I certainly didn't. Teachers have the privilege of inspiring curiosity, not only to ask the questions of when and where, but also of the who and the why. Primary schooling is well placed to not just consider dates and timelines, but to bring to life the stories of people and communities in relatable, creative and compelling ways. And I've certainly tried to do so over the years. The flexibility of the curriculum for excellence will always lead to debates over the syllabus, but we must, however, promote the gathering of evidence, questioning sources, analysing and understanding the implications and impacts, learning the lessons of the past to inform our tomorrows. But of course, the past is not all right, or indeed all white. Black Lives Matter has certainly brought into sharp focus the need to recognise that education is the route to tackling prejudice and building a more just and understanding society. Instrumental to that is the role of key individuals and organisations, and I will mention the Coalition for Racial Equalities and Rights that has been at the forefront of supporting Black History Month and developing materials to help teachers to plan inclusive history lessons, and their work should be recognised. Black History Month helps to recognise the people who have often pioneered civil rights in tackling racial discrimination. In telling the stories of the who, it enables the learners to explore the why of attitudes and cultures of the past to inform our futures. Equalities Minister Christina McKelvey said it's important that we recognise Scotland's role in these painful parts of history to ensure we learn from the mistakes and atrocities of the past and make sure that they are not repeated. I will take an intervention.
Yeah. Kenneth Gibson, if you could address the front. Kenneth Gibson, could you please?
Yes, apologies. Do you agree that focus on the transatlantic slave trade should actually help educate people about modern slavery in the world today? There is, according to the United Nations, 40 million people in modern slavery, including 20 million now in the Indian subcontinent, one in five people in Mauritania, many in the Middle East, for example. Do you think that that should help create a greater focus among nations, including Scotland, on dealing with that particular issue of the modern age, as well as looking to what happened in the previous centuries?
Co-Cab Stewart, I can give you the time back.
Thank you, Kerry Gibson. I do agree with that. What's unfortunate is the fact that maybe in the past we have not had robust enough debates to learn the lessons from the past slave trades in order to allow this to go on. But I accept what you have said there. Faith communities have played a significant role too, and I would like to mention the Scottish Jewish Heritage Centre, which is based in Garnet Hill, the first purpose-built synagogue in Scotland and a beautiful Category A listed building in the heart of Glasgow, which is now open to learners from not just Glasgow, you're welcome to come from Scarabray and from Islay as well. Telling the stories of real people that go back over 200 years. Based in Glasgow, the Colourful Heritage Centre also provides an excellent online resource highlighting histories and stories primarily of South Asians and Muslims within Scotland. A wee example I'll share is that in 1911, the Glasgow Indian Union was established to represent the seamen that worked down in the Govan area. And that was actually before the Red Clydesiders were established as well. And there was indeed a vibrant Lascar community in Anderson, in my own constituency of Kelvin. A fascinating local contextualised part of history to add to current debates about race and equality. The examples I give here have been driven from the experience and efforts of our black and minority ethnic individuals and groups, but it is encouraging to see this work being addressed more widely. Museums Gallery Scotland, in collaboration with race equality stakeholders, now recognises and represents more accurate portrayal of Scotland's colonial and slavery history. And Lucy Cascott, the CEO of Museums Gallery Scotland, said that Black Lives Matter movement has highlighted the critical need to understand and act on the racial injustice and colonialism that is still prevalent today. And I welcome the Scottish Government's support of that collaboration, but I would also like to ask for an update on how that is going. Of course, the Colston
Can you
four,
please conclude the round now, please?
I will do, thank you. I'll jump right to the end. So Voltaire, often quoted, including by Kenneth Gibson, "We look to Scotland for all our ideas of civilization." Remember, that was said at a certain time in history, and we need to make sure that we actually live up to that.
Mr. You really do need to conclude now.
"In an independent Scotland of the future, I look forward to reflecting on the lessons learned from the past to ensure a more just and equal society that acknowledges the contributions of and reflects all of its citizens." Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. I can't call another motion without notice. I now call on the Minister to conclude the debate for around 7 minutes. I can maybe give you a little longer if you can weave in reference to Scarabray.
Well, let me mention Scarabray at the outset, President Officer. I've never had the chance to visit, nor have I had the chance to visit the museum in Islay, so I look forward to visiting both in due course. This has, I think, been a really important and very enjoyable debate. It has been very wide-ranging, and you've quite correctly reminded me I have up to 7 minutes, President Officer, so I'll not be able to cover every point that has been made, but I'll endeavour to try and respond to as much of the debate as I can. But that should, of course, start by thanking Stuart McMillan for having brought forward the motion that has allowed us and enabled us to have this debate this evening. And I would join him in conveying condolences to all those who knew Gordon Bryce. I want to start off with the fundamental premise, which I think we're all agreed on, that learning the context of Scottish history is an essential part of the experience within our school environment. Many people have reflected, as they often do, and I oft hear their own experience at school and not learning enough about Scotland's history. I can say of my own, I was fortunate in that regard. I was able to be taught a degree of history of our own country when I was at school. That actually, and I'm sure Martin Whitfield will be delighted to know, sparked and generated such interest that it was a subject matter I went on to study at the university
of Glasgow, where I should say with regret to Murdo Fraser, his book was not on the suggested text at that juncture. I don't know if it is now. My own experience of higher education is probably falling into the historical presiding officer. Having mentioned the University of Glasgow, I would like to quickly join Jenny Minto in recording my own sadness at the passing of Ted Cowan. He was actually one of my lecturers when I was at university and a great and passionate exponent of Scotland's history. We have lost a great champion of Scotland's history as in the shape of Ted Cowan. But returning to the position of young people's experience of learning history, Scottish history at schools, I should say, yes, I understand why we reflect on our own experience, but reflecting on the current experience now, it is in fact actually a mandatory element of our national qualifications. There is a wealth of resource to be able to start that experience of learning about our country's history at the very earliest stages of education, and right through to senior phase, it comprises a core component of the history subject matter. I want to try and respond to some of the comments made by members over the course of the debate. As I say, I won't be able to respond to all of them, but a number were made, and they should rightly receive a response. Stuart McMillan, rightly, indeed a number of members, Stephanie Callan and other members, rightly spoke of Scotland's position in regards to our links to the historical slave trade, and in particular Stuart McMillan mentioned the position of the establishment of a museum on slavery in Scotland. I can say that we have an expert group led by Jeff Palmer looking at this area and looking at what form any museum would take, its scope, whether a physical museum is going to be recommended. It will be something that will become clear when the recommendations are delivered later this year. But I know that Stuart McMillan will continue to champion Greenock as a location for a museum, and I would expect him to do nothing less. Turning to the comments from Murdo Fraser, I have to say I was not surprised, given he took to Twitter to respond to some of the comments that we saw recently, that he was speaking in today's debate, notwithstanding, of course, his great passion for Scotland's history, which, of course, would be the other reason he wanted to speak. He mentioned the resource that was established, published by Education Scotland in relation to Red Clytide. I'll recognise here now there was an inaccuracy in that, and there's a method by which people can report that, and Education Scotland will reflect on that and change it where necessary. But I don't want anyone having any sense that Education Scotland or any part of the educational establishment will be doing these things willfully to deliberately mislead our young people with some form of a political agenda. And just to reassure Murdo Fraser, and indeed Mr Kerr, who also expressed some concerns, Education Scotland works in partnership with the University of Glasgow to produce the resources across the humanities curriculum area. So I think we can rely on their professionalism, and where a mistake is identified, of course we expect them to rectify that. That brings me on to...
I can give you the time back, certainly, Minister. Certainly latitude to take an intervention. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I welcome the reassurance he's given. But I wonder if he would address what was my concluding point, which is the issue of whether the teaching of history needs a proper review at this stage. If you listen to the entirety of the debate from all different perspectives, members expressed their concern that aspects of Scottish history were not being properly addressed within the curriculum. Isn't it now time to follow the advice of the Royal Society of Edinburgh and conduct that review?
Minister.
I suspect all of us have taken part in this debate because we have a passion for Scotland's history. It would be great if we could teach the entire breadth of the historical experience of Scotland. But I was taken with the point that Mr Whitfield made, that we have a curriculum that is designed to imbue and stimulate interest and spark a passion for its subject matter to be studied in its wider sense. But there is, and you know, there's no pretending that there's a limit to how much can be taught within the specific context of the school environment. But what I will say, and I was going to pick up on the point that was made and released to Professor McLennan's reported remarks, I first of all would make very clear and reiterate the point that, you know, our curriculum is not subject to political direction. But what SQA are currently undertaking is the preparation of a consultation and engagement with teachers of history in Scotland on the opportunities for the teaching of non-European and diverse perspectives within our history courses. That engagement will take place with the relevant professionals. It can, of course, take account of Professor McLennan's concerns that neither Glasgow nor Greenock were mentioned as a slave trading port. But I would respectfully suggest that their omission as some form of political plot seems a bit overstated. So hopefully we can place it in its proper context. President Officer, I probably extended your latitude as much as I properly can. I've not even been able to talk about the history of my own constituency, which I very much regret and hope I get the chance to be able to do at another juncture. President Officer, our curriculum will continue to focus on historical, social, geographic, economic and political changes that have shaped Scotland, that will focus on the... Well, I'll save the President Officer. Let me give way.
It's a very generous 7 minutes,
It's
Minister.
A very generous 7 minutes.
Kenneth Gibson.
About how we need to kind of, you know, talk about some of the negative aspects of Scottish history, and I think that's absolutely important because it should be warts and all. And slavery is an important part of our history, but why are we not teaching about positive aspects of our history, like, for example, our contribution to the world, such as the Enlightenment?
Minister.
Well, that was one point I had actually hoped to make in response to Mr Gibson, so you've enabled me to be able to do so. It isn't actually the case that doesn't form part of the subject matter. Actually, if you look at the Scottish Studies Award within our school's environment, young people can elect to study, for example, the Enlightenment as a topic within that award. Of course, I would certainly encourage them to do so, because going back to my own experience, Presiding Officer, that is an area I studied at university. It is itself not without some contention and, of course, debate about its place in historical context. The point I was going to make in concluding, Presiding Officer, is we will continue to make sure that Scotland's history is taught to young people, but it is also placed in a wider global context, so that we can ensure that the past informs our recognition, understanding and valuing of the diversity and the complexity of the modern world and modern Scotland.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.